Thank you. I'm pleased to be here to have this opportunity to tell this story. I've had very good colleagues at all points. I'm interested to see if Dr. Roy Scragg is here, former Director of Public Health in New Guinea, and Roy gave support to our initial studies on which everything else that has followed is based. The Chancellor is very kindly come along with his interest in elements and has the mining background, but he has a very broad, and I'm delighted that he's able to be with us. The University of South Australia has, of course, been a very strong interest since 1992. The buildings, of course, are very striking, and the drive and the expansion of the university is very gratifying, that one has lived long enough to see it really develop, and it's been my privilege to do that. This question of iodine deficiency, it has been my opportunity and privilege to create a new frontier, namely the brain. The problem of iodine deficiency, before we realised the importance of the brain, was simply a lump in the neck, goiter. It's enough to be make an impression, and one had to get away from the old image of iodine deficiency as goiter to a new concept of brain development. And that's taken a bit of time, but it's been my privilege to lead that fight, and I have had many wonderful colleagues on the way. So this lecture will focus to some extent on the global program, which I haven't really discussed before in Adelaide. It's been my particular concern following the creation of an non-government organisation with my colleagues elsewhere, particularly in the United States, in 1986. Before that, of course, came the research. So we begin with the research, which led to this global program. The importance of iodine is, it's of course a well-known element in various connections, but it's an essential constituent of the thyroid hormone, which is essential for normal brain development. So that, put simply, a shortage of iodine means that the thyroid hormone is not produced in adequate quantities, and all sorts of things happen, particularly to the brain. And we now know that the iodine deficiency is the most common preventable cause of brain damage in the world today, with an excess of 2 billion at risk from 130 countries. That figure should probably be reduced a bit because there has been a global program. But that was what we started with. Thank you. My personal experience is this problem, which began in Papua New Guinea when I was asked to go up and have a look at the problem in the highlands. Goiter, certainly, but also cretinism. A period involved with Indonesia followed, but then finally China. China's been the big event, most populous country in the world, with an enormous problem with iodine deficiency. The research led to the creation of the International Council for Control of Iodine Deficiency Disorders, which I had the privilege of founding with colleagues, international colleagues, and that has provided the scientific input to the program, essential, with the agency, the major agencies, the World Health Organization and UNICEF in particular, but USAID has played an important part in supporting the International Council for now 25 years, and that's the story. I was, of course, moving from one position. I was Professor of Medicine here, then Professor of Preventive Medicine in Monash, came back to CSIRO in 76, where we did the fundamental work on the brain in animal models, sheep and the monkey. Now, starting in New Guinea, some of you will know New Guinea. Important feature, of course, are the highlands, and the goitre problem, which had first attracted attention, was very evident in the highlands. And the classical ecological situation is demonstrated here. This is a village just near Lae, and in the highlands. And of course, these people lived in subsistence agriculture. They had a purely vegetarian diet of taro and sweet potato. And okay, that's all right, but the fact of the matter is it was grown in grossly iodine deficient soil. The rainfall here, 285 inches a year, steep slopes, and the soil is just washed free of iodine, of course, has been over centuries. That's the classical ecology. It's not always mountains. It can be flooded valleys, but on the plains. But that's where the problem. And here's the classical situation with this mother is this very big goitre, as you can see, with the child. There's no reasonable doubt that child has sustained brain damage. The gland works very hard in the absence of adequate iodine and can get as big as this. It can cause obstruction, but of course, and this is what, of course, fascinated early observers. But the problem is here in this youngster, a cretin child. You notice he's got a squint. He does require support because he can't stand up. He's a deaf mute and he's mentally impaired. Likely he also has some effect, spastic change in the legs. Pretty considerable insult, which indicates, of course, an effect early in pregnancy of the iodine deficiency. The mother can't form enough thyroid hormone for normal development. One of the new innovations in New Guinea was the use of iodized oil. Very familiar to radiologists, iodine contrast medium, iodized poppy seed oil, produced originally by the French with poppy seed oil from Algeria, been used as a radio contrast medium since the beginning of the 20th century. And it was a visiting chest physician who suggested this would be the way to deal with the problem in these remote villages where iodized salt, which of course had been the traditional remedy, was quite difficult to distribute. And this shows the APOs, aid post orderlies in New Guinea, backbone of the public health service, giving injections of iodized oil, which lasts for up to 5 years, depending on the dosage. And it was this availability of oil that led me to suggest that we should do a trial related to cretinism. And that was carried out in the Western Highlands Koinambi, a mission, Anglican mission, was the sort of site for the major study. The alternate families were injected with iodized oil and saline, and then the infants produced in the next 3 to 4 years were all examined in a certain area without knowledge of which group, control group or the injected, the women, families, alternate families were injected with iodized oil and saline was the control. And these cretins continued to be born in the area, in the control group, but disappeared in the treated group. You can see there that there were six above that line who were identified as pregnant already. This one, there's some doubt about the accuracy of that date, but you can see what has happened with the injection of the iodized oil. There's been prevention of the cretinism. These are coordination defects and delays in milestones, simple indicators, which Dr. Peter Farrow carried out, as I say, double-blind. When the code was broken, that was the message. Indeed, that the iodized oil had prevented the occurrence of the cretinism. So in one stroke, in a sense, the etiology was established. This is published in The Lancet in 1971 and accepted as definitive. There'd been quite a lot of controversy because the cretins in Europe, particularly in Alpine Europe, had spontaneously declined during the course of the 19th century. And in retrospect, it was clear that this reflected the improvement of the diet, so that the diet at the end of the century, with, of course, social development, had changed and the cretins had disappeared to some extent. They were less common. And that, of course, had been a bit of a distraction. However, in New Guinea, we had the opportunity of doing this study, and it's been absolutely definitive and accepted. So this opened up the whole question of a public health program of prevention. The Indonesia, we're quite familiar with Indonesia from Australia, an archipelago where there was a lot of goiter. And this is a family in central Java, in a village, Sengi village, near Semarang. Some of you may know Semarang. And here we have a family group. Here's Dad. He's a dwarf. He's a cretin dwarf. And that's his wife, who is normal height, but has neurological features of cretinism. And this is their son, one of three sons they had, following iodized oil in this village. The injection of iodized oil in this particular village was on April 1773. All villages were injected. Within a year, the whole village, which had been sleepy, came to life. Children were, this is the observations of my good friend Professor Joko Bonjanto in University of Semarang. Here these kids were playing happily when before they'd been quite sort of inert. Playing activities, games were played, and at the end of 74, Sengi received the honour for the best volleyball and chess player in the sub-district competition. And subsequently, the school dropout rate fell dramatically. Well, that experience has been repeated in China, India, and indicates the importance. Now, what we're dealing with is an iceberg phenomenon. The cretinism, the dwarfism and so on is up to 10% of the population severely affected, and then some only have a partial syndrome, and then there's quite a large group who are hypothyroid. The hormone level in the blood is low, but not so low, so that these are the people that come to life with the injection of iodized oil. They start forming enough hormone for normal function. Now, this was a fairly dramatic finding, and I realised we had to have more evidence to get credibility, so to speak, and I took advantage of the experience of CSIRO with trace element deficiency in the southeast. Cobalt and copper will be familiar to you, some of you, and I took advantage and came across to take charge of the division, vacant position of chief, and particularly with a view to developing a model of iodine deficiency in the sheep. And this shows the result of that in a very good group of scientists experienced with animal work. Severely iodine deficient diet was given, and this is the newborn lamb at the end of pregnancy. No wool, skeletal retardation, and higher mortality than the control. We, of course, could study the brain at leisure, so to speak, and here's the map of the brain development during pregnancy in the sheep. And the dotted line is the iodine deficient sheep, and the continuous line is the control. You can see there's no doubt about the retardation that occurs. The next slide shows data on fetal brain DNA, which follows, as you would expect, the weight differences. Here's the iodine deficient animal through to nearly term, and then this development, which of course is that's when the brain really expands during mid-pregnancy, is, and the retardation here is due to the maternal thyroidectomy as opposed to the fetal thyroidectomy. The both glands are important, the hormone produced for normal development of the fetus. Now, just to go into a little detail, the changes that occur with iodine deficiency in the brain are particularly in the cerebellum. And this shows you what happens during normal development in the rat, much quicker than in the sheep or in man. And it's this particular cell in the cerebellum which shows very clearly. You can see there's a sort of layer here of filled in dots. 21 days indeed is the gestation period in the rat. And what happens is these cells migrate into the centre of the gland, and then they flourish, they flower, so to speak. These are known as the Purkinje cells, and that's normal development. Well, what happens, of course, is that with the iodine deficiency, you can see here there's the control animal, cerebellum, and there's the iodine deficient animal, which shows that external layer is still much thicker than it ought to be because the cells have not migrated as they are here. You can see those are Purkinje cells there. If you take out the fetal thyroid, a fetal thyroidectomy, it has a similar effect to the iodine deficiency. This is maternal thyroidectomy, which is not so dramatic. But that is the definition of the effect of iodine deficiency on the brain, particularly evident in the cerebellum. Thank you. And of course, we also took advantage. The sheep and man are obviously rather different. So I was able to bring in a colony of marmosets from England, originally from South America, and you can see, comparing the control and the iodine deficient, we've got this is in the cerebellum again. The control has reached that point, but you can see there's delay in the external granular layer associated with the iodine deficiency. And that, of course, is important, but it's a primate model. It's similar to humans, and really clinched the situation. Obviously, you have to be sure, and millions have been spent on the iodine deficiency program as a result of this research. Thank you. We had to reconceptualize our thinking about the effect of iodine deficiency, and I introduced the term iodine deficiency disorders to cover the broad spectrum of effects affecting the fetus. Of course, mortality of the fetus was affected. We saw greater mortality in the lambs. Neonatal mortality, the child retarded development, and the adult, of course, with mature effects. So what happened, I suggested, that we had to drop the use of the word goiter because agencies are not interested in a lump in the neck. I mean, they're fighting life and death. On the other hand, with the concept of iodine deficiency, this is makes sense in and demands priority and attention. So that term iodine deficient, IDD, it's easy to say, has been used throughout the world, got rid of the term goiter as the shorthand, and the Chinese paid the compliment of using the term IDD without translation. Highly pragmatic people, and that was that. We were interested in a public health global program. It was known by this time that there was a WHO announced that there was in excess of 2 billion at risk in the world, we needed to think in terms of a public health program. And we had the basis, of course, in the work, both in humans and animals, with the definition of the brain. We then had to bridge the gap, and we needed a new concept, which IDD was, and we also needed a group to implement the concept with assessments of iodine deficiency in various countries. I remind you that WHO had agreed, published, that there were in excess of 2 billion in 120 countries. It was a big, big problem. So we had the task, we'll come to this, the World Summit for Children, adopted a series of goals, next, which were given priority. The ICCIDD was the NGO that we set up in 1986 after a preliminary discussions in 1980 through 1985 when I put this proposal that we do this. There were such groups for vitamin A and iron deficiency, and we needed one to cover the situation of assisting countries with their programs. And so we, that group is now 700 scientists from more than 100 countries, epidemiologists, clinical scientists, salt technologists, public health professionals, a diverse group. And we had, this was our logo, which of course emphasizes the brain. Okay, these are, we're now ready to look at the program. We had a series of regional meetings with WHO and UNICEF support around the world during the 90s, and we could say that by 2000, assessments carried out showed that 68% of households had access to iodized salt, compared with less than 20 before 1990. A very dramatic improvement in coverage, the result of our program of regional meetings, which individual countries would attend with their appropriate health personnel. So this was very encouraging. The 80 million newborns were protected, leaving another 40 million unprotected. There's still a way to go, but you can see obviously there's a difference between 20 and 68. This was the first meeting we held in Delhi, inter-country consultation involving WHO and UNICEF, there's the regional director, Burmese, Dr. Coco, WHO director is the director of UNICEF. Very helpful these gentlemen were. That's Professor Ramalingaswamy, the head of medical research in India, and Dr. Joko Moldanto. And that group, I put the idea of such a group as the ICCIDD to this meeting, and it was approved. I had quite a few consultations during the course of 1985, and it was in 1986 that we formally inaugurated the organization. My colleagues in the States, Dr. Stanbury, who was the elder statesman in the field, Harvard Medical School, Dr. Ramalingaswamy, you've seen his photograph, a noted figure in India, and I was the executive director and treasurer, for some reason or another, also invested with the treasurer position, my good friend Dr. Dunn, also from the States, who's a distinguished thyroid scientist. And then we appointed regional coordinators for each of the six WHO regions. I won't go into the detail of that, but that was essential to have the WHO regions covered and following up on the regional meetings that we had. It's interesting to note, Nepal was a country which we all know and esteem, but a very considerable problem. which now has, since the iodine program, virtually vanished. Next slide. An important event which some people recall was the World Summit for Children, held at the United Nations in New York, with the adoption of 27 goals, including the virtual elimination of IDD by the year 2000. We got onto that list. Here they are. And the Australian Prime Minister was not there, but this was 71 heads of state who signed this declaration. It was particularly managed by the executive director of UNICEF, Jim Grant, a remarkable, charismatic figure. Somehow or other, 71 heads of state came to New York, to the UN, and signed this declaration to abolish these 27 problems. Now, obviously, this can't be done overnight, and we were on that list, and that was the backing, so to speak, political backing, which had never been so significant with any problem before. And I'll take one example of China. China had an enormous problem, and they were latched onto the IDD notion very quickly. And when I went to China with a group from the Australian Academy of Science for looking at water problems, and I, on arrival in Beijing, I had a telegram from Tianjin, the port of Beijing, please come and discuss your work with us. They were very interested in the animal model, and we had a very exciting time. Dr. Chu was the leading authority in China, and this led to a national advocacy meeting in the Great Hall of the People. The Chinese, you recall, has a one-child family policy. They were, it was given top political backing. And when I say top political backing, I mean top political backing. An example, one fact is that this is a working group I'd set up a few years before, but this was a meeting in 89, and that gentleman is Mr. Deng Pu Feng. Who is he? Well, he is the son of Deng Xiaoping. You all must know who Deng Xiaoping is. He was, of course, the enemy of Mao. He was humiliated and persecuted. But after Mao's death, we had the Cultural Revolution, I remind you. The Cultural Revolution stopped when Mao died. Very necessary it was too, because my colleagues, appalling humiliation and the Red Guards and so on, so on. But to have him, what does he do? He's chairman of the Disabled Persons of China, which needless to say is a pretty big organization. And he was here, that was the fourth international group meeting in February 93, and September 93 we had the opening ceremony, the meeting in the Great Hall of the People, there it is, and you see the Chinese make use of the IDD, this is the top brass at the table, including Mr. Deng Pu Feng, including the chairman of the State Council. The State Council is the body that runs China. It's five people, and one person is responsible for health. This was attended by representatives from all 30 provinces of China, meaning governors or deputy governors, And I have brought along a booklet that was prepared for this meeting. It was pretty exciting to have sort of top political backing at a level that we do not know in the Western world. Thanks. An example of what was achieved, the Chinese, this is the production of iodized salt. A substantial loan following the meeting was negotiated through the World Bank, we show here the production of iodized salt in China, 93 to 205. And you can see the increase that has occurred from 95 to 2000. Enormous increase. And this was all negotiated, all made to happen. And of course, the Chinese program is the most successful in the world, and with remarkable coverage and appropriate benefits. Worldwide, by the year 1999, it said we did assessments with WHO and UNICEF, a percentage of households with access to iodized salt. These are the six WHO regions, and you can see the Americas, that refers to the American hemisphere, 90% coverage. In a sense, they got off to a flying start with iodized salt, with the American input, with John Stanbury led, and they have maintained their coverage. So that cretinism, which was formerly common, has virtually disappeared. The Southeast Asia is 70%, which is, of course, quite significant. Africa, 63%, dropped a bit. But the Western Pacific, helped by China, a 76% coverage. Eastern Mediterranean, 66%. But look at this, 27% is all Europe. That's the whole of Europe. And indicates a degree of inertia which is appalling. It is slowly improved, but the contrast between the inertia in Europe and the positive program in China just reminds one of difficulties that are translated into other areas of decision making and politics. Overall, it was 68%. And this was what compared with less than 20 before 1990. And since 2000, there's been further improvement. The reduction in the number of iodine deficiency countries, 03, was 54, 47, 07, 32, and 011. The impact of the whole program has increased or been maintained, which is, of course, very gratifying. And indeed, the WHO Director General pointed out that the achievement of IDD elimination will be a major total public health triumph, ranking with smallpox and polio, but in the elimination of a non-infectious disease. And that's the resolution in 1999. So that's the story, ladies and gentlemen. I marvel at it myself, but that's what has happened following the initial discovery or establishment of the brain as the major effect of iodine deficiency. Thank you very much.
Now, we have a little time for some discussion, comments, or questions. So is it the political activism that's required, with the science? What's keeping that number down?
Well, it's a very interesting question. It's clear, there's a report only this year of iodine deficiency in schoolgirls in England. Quite significant. Not, of course, bad enough to cause cretinism, but significant. And this has been looked into, and it is quite apparent, you see, one of the difficulties with iodized salt is you're talking about salt. And of course, there's a big lobby, and it's represented in Australia, wanting to remove salt from the diet. But that is not exactly practicable. The answer from our point of view is that there is no problem with the amount of salt that is needed to carry the amount, the necessary iodine. But it's been overdone, I think, in England, and the result is it's quite hard to get iodized salt in England. And so it's not surprising that here we are with schoolgirls, and of course it's only representative of the whole population of young group, are quite iodine deficient. Probably, certainly, recent studies show that the levels in the girls would be associated with some impairment of cognition.
It's pretty disturbing. Thank you.
Basil, is this an issue at all with disadvantaged communities in Australia?
Can I just repeat that for the people up the back? The question is this an issue at all with disadvantaged communities in Australia?
Well, it is. Quite a bit of work's been done. We have, you see, we can measure the urine iodine in a casual sample. It's suitable for population use. You can't give an individual assessment, but you can with suitable 100, 200 samples know where you are. And there are now studies indicating a degree of iodine deficiency in Tasmania has been the most iodine deficient state, also in Victoria, not quite so deficient here as Victorians are, but there is a problem, and in New Zealand, which has a rather more severe condition than we do, mountains and lakes, of course, they have done a study to show that if iodine is given, there is a defect in cognition which can be corrected by giving iodine. This is just to children in school who haven't got, of course, any of the more serious effects. So we're doing a study currently at Elizabeth and the school children there with the cooperation of the Education Department. Mr. Paul Fogarty is doing this study.
Thank you.
Fascinating lecture. Thank you very much. And I've been dragging it into the 21st century and tweeting all the way through it. I hope you don't mind. And it's interesting, I've got a tweet back from someone in Victoria saying that they've noticed that supermarkets are trending towards producing natural salt, not iodinized. Now, is this akin to the sort of fringe backlash that we've seen against vaccinations? Is there a don't iodinize movement out there on the fringes?
Yes, there is quite a lot of what could be called somewhat erratic interest in salt. Sea salt is and other salt from our special sources. Well, the sea salt's not really high, as it needs to be. The iodine in sea salt is about what you might expect. But it goes into the business of food fads and so on, so that there's quite a bit of competition, and I'm sure that occurs in England. People take an interest and get strange ideas. But there are various types of salt being sold with all sorts of claims, along with other claims of what could be called aberrant nature. People are free to choose, and of course they make the choices, and sometimes it's not good enough. There are hazards. Yes?
Do you know to what degree paediatricians are aware of this in informing pregnant mums of the importance of having perhaps iodine in their diet or iodine supplements?
So just for the people at the back, the question is, are doctors who are advising pregnant mothers aware and actively providing advice about dietary supplementation with iodine?
There are now recommendations about supplements for pregnant women. This is quite recent from the National Health and Medical Research Council. There is some argument about whether it's better to have the whole salt supply iodized, which covers people. To take pills is something not everybody manages to do, even if it's for their good, but there are socioeconomic differences and so on. The problem with supplements, and there is now, as I say, I answer the question, indeed supplements are recommended. But you can recommend them, but not everybody, of course, will take them. And that's why the advantage of universal salt iodization, which is the official recommendation of WHO.
John first.
So is there any work being done
delivering iodine through other sources apart from salt?
There's no particular information on that aspect. Salt is a very good vehicle. Initial work is now going on with bread. Iodized bread is now being studied in Sydney and in Tasmania, and indeed iodized bread is an acceptable vehicle as an alternative to salt. The hazard with salt, the level, I perhaps ought to make it clear, recommended current iodized salt, the salt intake is not excessive, it's within, well tolerated, doesn't cause a rise in blood pressure.
It's good to hear the story going about it every time, it's good. I learn things, but one thing you didn't mention, I think Peter Farrow puts in his book that the Jimmy used to get their water from a spring which had iodine, and when the shops came in, they bought salt in the shops, and that was when they started to get a real problem.
Yes. Yes, so that's a sort of natural epidemic. As you say, Roy Scragg says, and that happened to be where we did the trial, where we had a good iodine deficient population, which is fortunate. You can have a bit of luck in the game. But that's right. They had their natural sources did contain iodine, and then they switched, and they didn't have iodine. Yes, it's a basic element that you must have.
Thank you.
In China, as you mentioned, it's very successful in promoting iodine salt. Actually, it's very difficult for people to find salt without iodine in many regions. And in recent years, we saw an increase in the thyroid cancer, and doctors started to link this salt with the thyroid cancer. And there's quite a lot of discussion in the Chinese community. And since last year, the regulations on iodine salt actually has been changed slightly. It's not that strict anymore. And you can actually have access to the non-iodized salt now. And what's your comment? I know it's maybe not scientific to say the link between iodine and thyroid cancer.
Just for the people at the back, China appears to have moved from a place where it was very hard to get salt without iodine to a place where you can get more of that now, and it may be because there's a connection has been drawn between that salt intake and thyroid cancer.
I think the most common problem with iodine programs, and has occurred in China, is excessive thyroid secretion. Hyperthyroidism has been seen as a result of too much iodized salt. It is true that the dose needs to be regulated. The cancer, to my knowledge, is not a particular problem, but hyperthyroidism has been in the initial stages in China, but has been, in a sense, brought under control with more careful management. The salt needs to be monitored, there's no doubt about that. But, as I say, with the levels required, there should be no problems, and I think the problems in China that were initially have disappeared.
Would you please join with me in thanking Basil?